go ahead and just start the meeting. We'll go ahead and start with introductions. Bree, if you'll go ahead and start on your side, please.
Sure. Bree Galanti, Ohio EPA. I'm the site coordinator.
Adrian Harrison, board member.
Stan Kraft, board member.
Brian Huber, board member.
Carl Harvey, board member.
Dick Snyder, board member.
Frank Ballstead, board member.
Al Don Cisco, board member.
Will Henderson, chair.
Val Frazier, vice chair.
Joel Bradford, DDFO.
Greg Simonson, federal coordinator for the department.
Eric Roberts, EHI support staff.
Sir, we'll go ahead and turn it over to you.
Thank you. Hey, well, welcome everybody to tonight's March SSAB meeting. Feels like our semi-annual meeting instead of bi-monthly, and so we'll get into that in just a second. Got an agenda in front of you. Has everyone had a chance to review the agenda? And any changes or amendments to the agenda for tonight? Frank?
I recommend it be adopted as written.
Yes, sir.
Second.
A second from Adrian. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Outstanding. All right, we'll go forward with the agenda as presented. Approval of the December minutes. It's under tab 2 for you. So we're in March approving December, and if you read through the December minutes, it says we were approving the July minutes because of the shutdown and the chairs meeting. So, Frank?
Yeah, I recommend that we approve the minutes as written.
Outstanding.
I'll second that.
All right, Adrian seconded. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes that we need to make?
There's a typographical error on page 5. It's about halfway down.
Yes, sir.
See where there's a quote from Mr. Venture. So the call for a vote, the graphic representation.
Okay. Throw a preposition in there. All right. Are there any other changes or corrections to the minutes that need to be made? All right. Seeing none, we have a. Are we good to approve the minutes as amended? Do we need to do a separate motion for that? Or are you okay going forward?
We're okay
going forward. All right, all those in favor of approving the minutes as amended, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, outstanding. We're going to slide over to tab 3. Is there any EDFO comments? Mr. Bradburn, sir?
Thanks, Eric. Yeah, I'd like to also welcome everybody. Seems like it has been a while. I think my kids have been at my house more than they've been at school, which is not necessarily a good thing. Appreciate everybody's patience on the weather. I mean, obviously, we don't want somebody driving here to have an accident or something like that, including that stuff. The other thing, you know that spring is close to us this weekend, daylight savings time adjusting again. Don't forget to check your smoke detectors in your house at the same time. And I think I'm as ready to cut grass as anybody is. Give you a little bit of plan updates. Talk some about our regulatory process and our community outreach efforts, and then our upcoming events. So, picture here, just to kind of talk about, as we mentioned before, from 3/26, we've been doing Portsmouth sampling plan, doing our what we call our cut the cap activities, and that's going through and grabbing samples and cutting out and moving and shipping off-site processed gas equipment. If you remember, that's really just really three big pieces of that. That's a converter, a compressor, and a cooler. Well, we've been mostly shipping converters off. And so what we just recently did is we started shipping compressors off. And so we kind of run these things in campaigns to make sure that we have basically all of our analytics in order and our transportation requirements in order. So we just recently, again, this picture shows, can't really tell from the picture, but in those bags are four compressors, and they're being shipped off-site out west to Nevada. Flip over to the next page. Actually, since we're talking about compressors, so you can see in the picture up on the top right, the things look like great big hair dryers are the compressors. And then you can also see a converter there in the center. And so what you see going on is basically our cut and cap activities up on the South Florida 326. So some of the other interesting things going on, basically all the equipment's coming out, similar to how it went in and how it's been maintained. One of the big challenges has actually been getting the cranes in the 326 operational. We've got 20 cranes in 326. They're the original cranes installed back in 53 from Pacific Coast Engineering Company. And as you might imagine, a 53-inch crane, there's not a lot of spare parts available for that. Right? And so because they're integral to our operations up there, there has been a lot of time and dedicated effort focused on getting the cranes operational, ensure they're operating safely, and then keeping them operating. And just recently, we hit all 20 cranes in the building operational. And that was pretty much to the credit of some dedicated crews. What you see up there in the top left-hand corner, we've got a crane reliability crew. And then, of course, the operating crew was in the centerfold at the bottom of the picture. So, anyway.
So these are all maintained internal?
Maintained internal, yes, they are. The next one we had, we talked about pump and treat operations that we have going on around the site. In this particular case, over around what we call the PRQ at landfill, we've got a leachate collection, or basically a leachate collection system around the landfill. It's really more of a French drain system where the water runs into this perforated piping, and then it gets transported down into what we call manholes. That basically, similar to a sewer system, and then there's a pump in the manhole, and then we use the pump to transfer it to the water treatment system. We had a leak in one of the transfer lines, and we had Wise Construction on site did the repair on it, but I thought it was a good opportunity, aside from mentioning it, to also show you, what that transfer pipe is. And so it's basically a pipe within a pipe. So the center pipe, it's about 3 inches in diameter, is what actually transfers the leachate to the treatment facility. And then that secondary pipe is really the housing around it. And so, we monitor flows and look for this kind of stuff routinely. And so in this case, when they turn the pump on to transfer it and they suddenly got no flow, then obviously, hey, there's a problem somewhere on the line. And then Wise came in, they ran a camera bore scope down through the line, found the leak, and we ended up running a replacement line that held a better flow and capacity for future use. But anyway, just so you know what these things look like out there. And
what's the time frame of this picture? This is back in the fall?
This is winter.
That's winter.
This is like November. We were going to start it in July, but then we ran into some issues. So they started it late October, and we finished up by Christmas, I believe. I remember being out there being really cold.
What did you find was coming out of the leak?
It was contaminated groundwater.
That's all it was?
It was, yeah, that's all. I mean, the pipe was there specifically to transfer contaminated water to the treatment system. And it's all double walls, and that's
an underlying landfill, isn't it?
PDQ, yes.
So what I'm thinking is that water coming out of that landfill, or is it being stopped before it gets in there?
This one is not so much out of the landfill as it is runoff from the landfill.
It's between, this line is coming between PDQ and 749 in that area. So it's acting almost like a French drain collecting the contaminated groundwater that's there and taking it to treatment.
Okay. And so we have several inputs into this manhole. This particular was the
where you pump it from the manhole, in this case over to 622, the water treatment facility. But anyway, so Wise Construction did it, and people out of the local hall, and they worked there, so. Another thing, just want to talk to you a little bit about, you know, plan updates. Again, as everybody knows, you know, the site's pretty much like a city unto itself, and we had our struggles with wintertime as well. Some of the big things going on, you know, obviously, we have the new package boilers there, and getting down into the negative digits doesn't make anything happy. So we had a struggle, you know, kind of keeping those online. They provide heat to some of our buildings out there, as well as they provide steam to all the clay processes over in 344, which, you know, we all know is important, our, you know, our barter, cylinder transfer stuff. And so that was pretty much a yeoman's effort keeping those boilers up. But again, you know, nothing really is happy running out there at negative 11, 12, 18, 19, that kind of stuff. The other thing, of course, just like everybody else, you know, with about 1,200 acres of facilities out there, we've got about 1,200 acres of fire protection sprinkler systems. And so that was the other challenge that we had through the wintertime is operable fire protection systems. We had had some leaks. We had some intentional isolations. But, you know, a lot of dedicated effort from our emergency preparedness bunch, fire protection services, our engineering and maintenance folks keeping the place online. And then, you know, putting appropriate comp measures in place when we had problems. One of the bigger ones we had in 326, we did have a sprinkler system break. And so, you know, we haven't had any problems to date. And when we started getting the really, really cold weather, we monitor temperature in these, we call them doghouses in there. But we monitor temperature in there to make sure that things don't freeze. Okay, well, you know, it doesn't take much when you're talking negative 18 or 19 and the wind blowing. It really sucks the heat out of stuff. If your thermometer's not exactly in the right place, then, you know, there's a big temperature gradient there. We had one of the sprinklers heads freeze, and then we had a break. And it took us about 2 hours to isolate that line because the post indicating valve, you know, hadn't been operated for probably 40 years. So they responded quick to the scene, but we probably put about 20,000 gallons, you know, on the floor up there. And then, you know, of course, you know, the staff took the appropriate actions, de-energized equipment up there. We did have a period of time where we didn't have some cast systems operable, but that was because they were, you know, in the locale, and they were part of, and they de-energized equipment to make sure everything was maintained safely. But recovered from that. That was probably our biggest incident. We're just interested on the news, listening to some of the other, you know, municipalities having similar problems, kind of, you know, quick to share their
staff skating on that much water.
There's a lot of water. So anyway, that, you know, between the sprinkler systems, you know, the boilers, that really was the biggest deal. Other than, you know, slips, trips, and falls, you know, with the icy conditions out there. So we did have some people get injured, you know, just because winter weather kind of caught them by surprise in some cases, and tough walking spots. If you've driven around the site, you might have seen some changes too. We did, these were old USAC signs, and you just kind of feel compelled to put some up there in its place. So we added a little bit of signage up there, Department of Energy sign, and then the DD project. These were actually done by there's a sign shop. 720 building, I think that's, so if anybody knows Mike Casey, Mike compliment him on his work. So he built, made the signs, and I believe Lynn's put them on. So, groundwater, so we were talking a little bit about that. And you see X22 down there, give you some idea of where that leachate line was going to. But anyway, just to kind of put it in picture right there, in 2014, just as a note, in 13, I think we treated about almost 30 million gallons of groundwater, and then about, so you can see we're about 10 million gallons right now, about halfway through the year, so that's pretty much part of the course. Just to give you some idea of our various bucket treatment operations. Regulatory process. So, you know,
we talked about, you know, the concept of using some of our landfill, landfills and some of our, you know, contaminated soil out there as fill. We had, you know, from the department side, we had some folks come in from Corps of Engineers to kind of vet, you know, that it did make sense to take that strategy if, you know, if we had the opportunity. What you see up there is a visit from those folks. They did agree with our approach. They said it makes sense to, if you're going to have using an on-site option, using contaminated soil as fill instead of clean soil, you know, makes sense. From waste disposition, RIFS process, I think that little triangle is moving up a little bit closer to the proposed plan. We did get, I think we had some pretty collaborative sessions with Ohio EPA. I think working through the final language and the stuff, we transmitted what we call our D3 version over in, and I think everybody's been reading until they can't read anymore, and I think we're pretty close. So I hope by the next time we convene the board that we'll be able to say we're in the proposed plan space.
Proposed plan for what?
Well,
where are we? Are we still talking about eliminating all the landfills? Is that the direction we're still going? I mean, I know we are, but I'm saying Ohio EPA and DOE.
What I have is you have to understand the regulatory process, and the decision is either for on-site disposal or on-site with off-site or totally off-site. So that's the one, that's the waste disposition, RIFS, where you take it into account either off-site fill or on-site borrow areas. So you can leave that and take that into account. But that doesn't make the decision of whether you're digging out the landfills or not. And then you have the process building, which is either the buildings stay up or the buildings come down. And those are the decisions that you're making, and that's what the proposed plan will evaluate.
So maybe a better slide that we hadn't. Actually, I think the folks tried to just, you know, kind of mix up the slides a little bit. But if you remember back some of the previous presentations we had basically all the decisions up there that go into, you know, getting a full bore into the field and stuff. And so, you know, one, there's a balanced plan ECA, right? And that was, we settled that a while ago, and that identified, you know, a lot of the balance of plant facilities. Do they stay up or do we tear them down, right? And so it's been probably 18 months ago. Now that one's, you know, already under a mill, right? And so then you got three other big ones, right? And in our case, you got the two RIFS, record of decision activities here. That's waste disposition, and that's just as Maria, you know, described, you know, on-site, you know, some off-site or off-site. That's really all the decisions making, and then so part of that, you have to evaluate, you know, all the technical aspects of that. We've had several presentations from you guys. And then the other piece of that's a process building, so really that decision is, they stay up, or we get taken down. And then the third piece there is really the corrective action side, the ripper side of the shop, and that is all the, you know, the environmental media. And so what do we do with that? And so that's actually progressing, I'd say, pretty well too, with the RFI and the process, which is similar to the RIFS process.
Yes.
On the surplus side. So the biggest is the waste disposition one, the process building, you know, is not as complex as the waste disposition. The plan is to roll those two proposed plans out at the same time, so pretty much at the same time, right? Just because you really need both to get the context of it. You can't really, you know.
Not either or.
It's not either or, so you've got to kind of take them both together. And that is just the regulatory framework that we've got that we have to follow. It's kind of like, you know, I'm tired of the cold weather, but I can't do anything about it.
Well, I read something today that showed 2015 budget projections, things that, and when you went back to where Portsmouth was, it listed Paducah, and it said Paducah is still trying to decide, or it's still up in the air whether they're going to be on-site or off-site. But the language for Portsmouth said on-site sell. So that's where I was coming from. Has that been decided? Or obviously it hasn't, but listening to you guys tonight, that was the language that I'm sure everybody here got a copy of that. It was like a 60-page document.
Based on...
It's there.
Mark Jewett's briefing at the last waste subcommittee, as I understand it, it is part of their plan, but there's a regulatory process to go through. Where we are right now, the proposed plan is coming up, and that'll include, from what I understand, is that the landfills will be included in that. However, when you get down to the soil and groundwater decisions, that's where I'm confused. Where is that phase going to include discussions or decisions on the RCRA waste facility? After Mark Jewett briefed us, but now I'm hitting computers.
I'll say, remember some of the discussions past we talked about that, basically the regulatory decision process. And so really, basically above grade structures. We're dealing with, at least, from our standpoint, from the circle process, and through Ohio EPA, we kind of made the agreement with the DFF and direct response planning boards, okay? This is how we're going to do the circle process for the above grade stuff. All right, now for the below grade stuff, we really follow the RCRA process. And for that, so we'll talk about, you hear us talk about consent decree, and it's a very similar process, but it's a different regulatory part. So really and that's been our challenge getting through this waste disposition thing, is how do you marry these things up, because it's all got to hang together, right? And unfortunately, the regulations are almost exclusionary, and I have to talk about stuff. So that's been the big challenge about, okay, this one's in this language, this one's in this language, but we've got to do the work in the field, and orchestrated function, because if you're going to use soil from one of the pollutant areas, you need that. At the same time, you're going to be placing waste in an on-site disposal stuff. So that's what's taken us so long to sort through all the detail of that. And then, of course, we got to present that, for comment to the public. We're going, hey, look, so we evaluated all this stuff, and then here's what we think. And, okay, we invite comment on that. And so, again, there's a challenge there going, okay, this is crazy. We're struggling with this stuff. How do we make this and present it to somebody that they can understand and reasonably weigh in on? And so that's why the process doing the waste disposition, you really need those together. And I'm sure with best intentions they were split, But as always, what you actually end up with is never what you thought you'd have. And so, probably in hindsight, you go, I didn't need two, we just need one, but we are where we are, and so we got to present two. On the budget stuff, I don't have a slide here of the budget because it just got rolled out, and part of the protocol is we have to put this in, in advance. We have a 72-hour notification stuff, but just to talk a little bit about it. So if you look at the top end number, what rolled out, 222, it says you got a plus. Really what that means is they gave us some consideration for our drop in our uranium prices. So we haven't had a chance to fully vet all that stuff. We think we're basically going to have even for the last year. Okay, we'll have to go through it now and that way to figure out what that means. When you talk about an on-site disposal cell, that falls into a different budgetary process, authority process. In our case, it's called a line item capital project. And that says if you think you're going to spend any money, you have to put a placeholder in, at least in advance of the year that you're working the budget. And so that's when you see that's no guarantee of anything. That is just a placeholder. So obviously, if it ends up and we don't have on-site disposal, then that money doesn't. And it's fenced off. We can't apply that to any other work at our site. So that's how that works. So that's just more of a figment of the budgetary process. So everybody knows there's no guarantees at all.
Can I ask Maria a question? Maria, in past conversations, we talked about the fact that those landfills were already closed, and that was a problem with regulatories, regulations, and with attorneys and all that kind of stuff. Are we moving? Are we finding a path forward on that?
Yes, we are finding a path forward.
Good.
So, there, as Jill said, everything, all the stars have to align. Because you can't make one decision in a vacuum. You can't. You have to know that all these decisions have to line up. Because you can't have a landfill without getting fill. And so you've got to make certain assumptions about where that fill would come from in order so that you could appropriately cost the project. So if you look at the waste disposition RIFUS at this point, there's you'll see five categories. These are six. You'll see RC1, RC2, RC3, and RC4, which are the regulatory categories. What does each bit of waste, what regulatory category does it fall into? Then you'll see two engineering categories. One is soil, and one is debris or waste. We don't like the word debris because it means something else regulatorily. But so you'll see how it was broken out and how we take into account that DOE can have clean fill from on-site or use contaminated fill from on-site or use fill totally from off-site. And you'll see how it's broken down and clustered out. So that's how we had to do it to make sure that everything fit into the right regulatory category and that it's clear what the decision is being made in each document and where those other decisions need to be made. So I think it worked out well. And we are close.
Yeah, we're close. So the other thing to remember is what those things are. And those are really a detailed analysis of these different options. So you're going, all right, so if it's this one, then here's all the technical stuff and all the kind of stuff that goes with that one. And it's this one, here's all the technical stuff that goes with that one. It's a lot.
I'm big.
Especially when you have to draw a line in there that's really hard to draw in the first place. So it's taking a long time. But I think we're in a really tough spot, and that is how you really split this.
Joel, you mentioned a little while ago about the line item in the budget. Is that line item for the RCRA?
No, so that goes into, if you look at the budgetary process, so you mentioned that you can see, there's a line in there for on-site disposal stuff. Okay, and that's all I'm saying is that's the congressional process says that you got it for a line item, and that is, really gets into if you're going to improve it or something like that. You got to specifically call that out, and the president has to take that to Congress. And that's all that is. That's pull that out and specifically.
Well, what are we calling that? The work that involves the
construction. If we have an on-site disposal cell, you got to flag that, and that's got to be specifically authorized. They can't just go, hey, we're going to fund, Portsmouth. $1 million, and we get to pick and choose what we spend it on for a capital project to go, hey, this is fenced off in the event you do this. And that has to be put out to the FY15 budget.
At that discussion in the last waste meeting, your counterpart,
Melody?
She mentioned that the timing has to be very good here because you cannot exhume the RCRA sites and have that stuff sitting around waiting to be put in the on-site disposal cell. We can't store it, as I understand it, in a permitted facility setting.
There are certain rules and regulations that if DOE wanted to exhume certain material and put it in a pile that they would have to meet. So there are rules and regulations that they would have to meet. But the timing, this is all, it's a dance. If you know you're taking down, for instance, when you're ready to take down 326, you already have to identify where your fill is coming from. Because as that building comes down and is transported over to the OSDC in you know, they're going to know that we're bringing converters that are segmented, for instance, and the converters will be there, but our transite and whatever they have to package around, they have to know. So they have to know, you will have a plan a year in advance. It will always be almost a year in advance to know where they are and where they're getting the fill from and how they're going to do it. When you look at these documents, and I don't know if you will or not, I'm glad it was a cold winter because I didn't mind staying inside and reading, but you'll see there's a whole appendix that talks about the regulations, and they're called the ARRs, and they're really all the rules DOE has to meet in order to be within the regulatory requirements. So there are rules that they can stage waste.
So but anyway, then, you know, if you remember back, we talked, so we said at the site, we evaluated, you know, using contaminated, you know, soil, digging up the plumes and the landfills, right? Well, that has to be vetted, okay, by somebody independent from us, obviously, at the headquarters level. In this case, the headquarters pulled in the Corps of Engineers to look at it and say, okay, let me see what you're doing. Let me see what your strategy was. You know, was your cost model, did it make sense? Is it truly, you know, in everybody's best interest, including the taxpayer, to go that route? And what they came up with is that, you know what, it does make sense. And so that's really kind of the, you guys remember, there's a lot of discussion on, well, DOE, can you, you know, are you okay with this stuff? And go, hey, you know, you got to get that box checked from some higher authority. Well, that's the bunch that came in here and did that. They looked at me, and actually I think they said, yeah, it does make sense based on what you got. So based on our site, what we have, you know, basically there's not a lot of complex stuff like some of the other sites might have. So in our particular case, you know, they're saying it makes sense. And so that's then, you know, we incorporated that kind of thing through this waste disposition, RIFS piece.
Excuse me, Joel, could you speak in the microphone so that those in the audience can hear what you're saying?
So, do you guys hear me okay on that?
Okay.
Yes.
Sorry about that.
So anyway, that's really where we're at. Waste disposition, RIFS, D3's over to Ohio EPA. They're pretty much into it. Process building, RIFS, comments should be coming back. We've gone through the toughest ones. I don't think that the process building will be as complicated as the waste disposition. For the third piece down there, for the soil, environmental media piece, under the RCRA process, process, we're working that as well through the RFI that's been transmitted to Ohio. They gave us comments back on that. So. Again, the next one we should be talking about, you know, proposed plan and rolling that out.
I'm going to belabor.
Go ahead.
There's one more question. If this goes through the way we're discussing and the way we anticipated, this will eliminate a lot of pump and treat, probably not all, but in the landfill area.
You have
dig those up.
Landfills and plumes. It depends on the extent, I'll just say it depends on the extent of excavation. I'm hoping it eliminates a lot of pump and treat. But you have to, there's already ongoing corrective measures, so we'll have to continue those until.
We'll continue to have monitoring wells, even after all.
We'll continue to have extraction wells. We'll continue to have pump and treat until such time as the remedies are implemented.
So the other thing you just got to bear in mind is this isn't an overnight deal. This is a, you know, getting through, you know, the entire site is a, you know, we're talking a long time. So
it's a 30 plus year project right now.
Depending on how much money.
Mm-hmm. A challenge to figure out how much material is from the old nickel plant out there. Where is it? How does it land? Have we done in depth surveys and that to have an idea of what you got there?
So they've done a lot of historical research, and that was, you might imagine, that's part of the cost. And analysis there. You have to have some, you know, basis of estimate. That basis of estimate is based on the case of land, the volume, the type of materials it might have, and the complexity of excavating, removing, relocating, and so on.
Well, ground penetrating radar can give you quite a good idea of what kind of hurdles you're going to face. And any knowledge you get is going to be a plus.
Right.
So we basically have a pretty good idea of what's in everything except meter, with keyword. Is that?
I would say we have a pretty good idea. We have an idea.
An idea.
Well, I mean, so you think about it. So that's, you know, one of the things we had here. Some of the other sites were, you know, did a lot of other different things. You know, at Portsmouth, we're fortunate. I think that most of the operations at Portsmouth were direct support of gaseous diffusion plant operations. And so you pretty much know what you generate, you know, when you're operating gaseous diffusion plant. And so that's what you might expect to be, you know, disposed of in the legacy landfills. And some of the other sites are not quite like that. You know, they did a lot of, you know, emissions on the site. You know, Portsmouth was pretty unique to, or specific to gaseous diffusion plant operation. Just a little bit about the DUF 6 plant. Still working on shipping them, Frank. But production-wise, I think they're looking at 14 to be an incrementally better year than 13. So in 13, they emptied 511 cylinders. And we're about halfway through 14. They've gone through 331. So, you know, a lot of previous years have been, you know, startup. They're working the bugs out, and I think they're looking at having all three trains operational for a continued period of time, and so you'll see the production ramp up a little bit. So that's been actually going pretty well. A little bit about community outreach. So again, this, you know, we're having this thing in March, but a lot of what we're talking about here was over the holidays. And just kind of neat stuff to point out. So I believe FBP, as part of their, you know, Christmas contribution to their employees, provided everybody a frozen turkey. Well, not everybody needed one frozen turkey, so then they donated it to, you know, to the local Pike County Outreach Council. So yeah, that's a Waverly food pantry right there. Mm-hmm. And I think that was very well received by the local community. That, I mean, you know, everything's kind of tight. In addition to that, you can see up there in the right-hand corner, they had, as part of the Christmas gifts for children, I think there was a campaign, some of you may have been involved in that. So from a volunteer standpoint, the volunteers raised $11,000. I think then the local contractors here, that's for USAC, WIMS, BWCS, RSI, and some local businesses got an additional $15,000 in contributions. And so, the local season and the local families here, about $26,000 for the stuff was raised. So we went to a Christmas fund, and so folks signed up for that, and I thought that was a, you know, that's what it's all about. Sure, good. Outreach and public tours. So again, you know, the weather's going to warm up. We're kicking off the public tours again. This year we're looking at 8. We are having this basically one a month. And the first one kicks off March 15th. As a matter of fact, if you listen to the local radio, then you probably heard it advertised. Mm-hmm. Another popular event is the Regional Science Bowl. Again, this is a little bit different than the Science Alliance. This one is a DOE-sponsored event. And our region is comprised of our 4 counties, and this will be held tomorrow at Shawnee State. I wonder if which gets to make a trip to compete in the National Science Bowl. So it's really a really cool deal. Upcoming events. So again, Science Bowl, as I mentioned, tomorrow. The next full board meeting is going to be April 3rd. We've got a meeting today coming up, and that's just where we invite the, you know, local meeting to come in and see the place, offer them, you know, tours, and just so they get a refresh understanding of the site. And then we got some public meetings. You know, as we get a little bit more insight of this proposed plan rollout, we can be talking about those and listen to
appreciate the discussion during the presentation. Are there any additional questions for Joel?
I've got one. With respect to those bags that we're shipping, compressors, is there a permeability rating for those?
Those are DOT compliant bags. So there's a specification that's going to be associated with them.
And some of the workers that I've had in my classes lately were asking me about it. I said, well, you know what the brand name is, and they don't know. And they said that they were told that they examine the bags, and if there's a tear or a scuff, they'd use duct tape to seal it. There's no permeability in the duct tape. But they also mentioned that if there's a big tear, they have more of this material that they're supposed to glue over the tear. So with all the bad PR that Hanford and the website have been doing lately, I was just wondering. They don't know.
We'll pull some information together and present it.
I was real disappointed. I asked the plant shift superintendent about this, and his comment was he didn't know, he didn't care, it wasn't his problem, and he made no effort to make a phone call to find out.
We'll get some information.
Appreciate it, thank you.
Other questions?
All right, thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
We'll slide forward to federal coordinator comments.
I just wanted to highlight tomorrow's Science Bowl. We have grown into 27 teams this year, and that's going to make for a little bit of a long day because our format will have them playing. The winners will probably finish up around 5 o'clock. But a lot of thanks goes out to all the different companies that have helped sponsor this to purchase the supplies necessary. Floor's community fund bought the equipment this year, so we didn't have to beg, borrow, and steal it. We have, I believe it's 19 school districts represented, is that right? 16 with 27 teams, and tomorrow it's supposed to be sunny and 51 degrees, and so for Joel's sake, I was in charge of the weather again.
What a guy.
So anybody that wants to come down there, you're welcome to, and again, we gave you a sample of questions last year from the junior high competition, which we don't have junior high. It'll restore your faith in the kids and in the future of this country when you hear the questions and the way that they can answer and the logic they use to go through it. It's extremely impressive. And our kids, last year showed us that we've got some real sharp kids and some great schools in our region. So if you want to come down to Shawnee State, it's in, we've got a couple different locations, but if you come to the main activity center, that's where they'll be, and starting about 9 o'clock and finish up around 5.
Will you put anything on YouTube so that we can see it and I can get it to the teachers in my region?
There will be, there is some social media, and it's actually through the Portsmouth Civic Forum that will do some like tweeting during the day. There'll be some pictures posted to that, I'm assuming YouTube. But to be honest with you, I'm not well versed in social media today.
Okay, just asking.
But yes, there will be some available. There was some from last year as well.
Okay.
All right. Any questions for the third party? That don't involve social media?
I'm all good.
Paducah just wrapped up their Science Bowl. I guess their third one this time. It was really neat to see the kids. The schools have been through it a time or two, so they figured out how it works. And the idea of the trip to Washington is clearly set in. So you saw like came with like strategies and they had prepared. And it was a completely different year this year from last year. So I'm looking forward to seeing them tomorrow. I love the local schools put in time and effort. All right, liaison comments.
I really don't have much. Joel and I have been talking about it. We're in the process of reviewing documents, getting comments back, and hopefully we'll have the RIFIS process wrapped up no later than the end of April.
Perfect. Any questions for Murray?
Quiet group.
All right, so we're going to slide forward on the agenda to our presentation tonight. Greg is going to walk us through a presentation entitled Infrastructure Projects. I know it's been a hot topic for the board for quite some time. Greg's going to update us on some of the things that are taking place. Thank you, Eric. And wanted to give you an update on infrastructure, but also to encourage you to be a continual partner in the regulatory process, the proposed plan, as that comes out, the public comment period. And so to do that, like I do all the time, it involves a little bit of the story. And I think it's important to take a couple steps back and then work through to where we are now and get to the infrastructure updates that we have for you. Cindy. So basically, six pieces, about eight slides. I promise that I'll be as brief as possible. But quick facts. A lot of this is review, but I need to do it again. 3,700-acre approximate federal site. And there's a picture of it, pretty much accurate today. You see the switch yards removed. Current operations, the D&D project, which is a subject to what we work on a lot. American Centrifuge project has a presence, as well as the depleted uranium hexafluoride conversion plant. Still around 2,700 people employed at the site in the different projects. Going back to when the plant was built, and these pictures are great, and a lot of these are on the virtual museum, but to think that this was built over a period of 4 years is pretty incredible. And I love this picture here. This is a piece of marketing information that was assembled by local leaders. And it says, an invitation with proof that the Portsmouth area of Ohio and every segment of its citizenry wants an atomic energy plant. And I had a copy that I gave it to Sharon to put in the local museum. But that to me was a neat picture. But you can see these pictures, in my mind, show the complex nature of what we had. It is truly a marvel of engineering. We've talked about that before, but it's important to remember that with all the people that came in to build it and operate it, it also transformed the community. It molded this community. A lot of Sunday school teachers, baseball coaches, elected officials, all came in either through the construction or the operation of the plant. It's hard to believe that Pike County hosted 22,000 plus workforce to build this thing. That's one of the reasons why it got done so quickly. Obviously, overnight, the plant became a staple of the regional economy, and even after construction, it still has maintained status as one of the largest employers in Southern Ohio. Val, you recognize the street?
I do.
I grew up down there, too. Hillside Avenue.
Yeah.
And I can walk you down the Harknesses, Blosses, Smith, Purvin, Payne, Simonton. Val, you lived in that area too.
Across the street.
At the end of it is Jeff May, the pastor's son, lived there. He's kind of ornery.
Yep.
But the important thing about that picture is, with all the people that came in, a lot of housing needs. And a lot of infrastructure needs came about with that. A lot of times it's kind of, you kind of hear, well, this community relies on the federal government too much. They expect a handout. We don't look at it like that. We look at this as a partnership. In fact, for those of us that grew up here, we understand that firsthand. When you think about infrastructure, had a lot of need with a lot of people coming in for expanding or building sewer plants. The federal government came in and gave grants to the Village of Waverly, Village at the time. The Village of Piketon had a grant to build a sewer plant. But they didn't just expect a handout. They also passed local bonds and local levies and used their own resources and built a water plant in the Village of Piketon. Built one in the city of Waverly, Village at the time. And so the infrastructure needs swelled, the federal government helped, but the locals stepped up and did their part too. And basically it was about a 50-50 split when you look at the numbers for the expansion of the sewer capacity and sewer plant construction in Piketon or Waverly. Spent about the same amount of local money on the water systems to expand to support the workforce that came in. So anytime you hear that this community relies on the federal government, we look at it as we rely on you too, and we have a true partnership. Eric? Social impacts, obviously, a big impact. Education. A lot of kids came in with their fathers working at the plant, mothers working at the plant. A lot of kids came in. So it's not perfect. Yes, there was a lot of construction. Three temporary schools were built. Some of them became permanent. But there was one, actually two, in what's now the three, in the Scioto Valley District, Piketon District. But one was Scioto Township, which is where Good Shepherd Manor is. One was up here on Pike Hill because there was a housing project up there, and they built a temporary school. Also in Jasper, which is still used today as an elementary school. So three were built temporarily. Also, there were permanent projects that were built in seven districts around Scioto, Jackson, and Pike County. There's seven districts that participated. Again, the federal government put up a lot of that money, but so did the locals. And so, you know, it may not have been perfect. In fact, the school over here on top of Pike Hill never had the first student in because the workforce left before it was done. But it takes a little bit of time to build public infrastructure. But being Appalachians and being resourceful, Pike County created the first joint vocational school district right here in that school that was empty. They took that school and what could have been a burden or a sob story, and they turned it into a joint vocational school district. First one in the state of Ohio. Val, you might be interested in this one. First Baptist Church. If you look at the history of the First Baptist Church, construction workers that were Southern Baptist didn't have a church in the area to attend. And so they started meeting in each other's houses. In 1953, they started borrowing the Presbyterian Church. In February of 54, they built what's now the First Baptist Church in Green Acres, a little subdivision in Waverly. The next year, they added on because it kept growing. And in 1957, they actually built the new church where it sits today at the corner of 3rd and East Street. And they've added on since then. But that's an example of how the community gets transformed. It's the First Baptist Church started because some construction workers didn't have a local church to be able to attend. Eric? But as we go forward, we all know there's a lot of changing conditions. Operations of the plant ceased in 2001, went through the cold shutdown, standby. Now we're into the D&D. I think it's important. One of the messages to keep going forward with is the regulatory process has been clearly established on how we make these key decisions. That involves extensive public outreach, and you guys have had a lot of input into that. The advisory board itself has been created to provide the department with a local perspective on the decisions we make. We've implemented an extensive outreach program, envoys, the neighbors meetings, the public meetings, the involvement with the local schools, the universities, civic organizations, regular meetings with elected officials. We've really ramped up the outreach efforts, but that doesn't mean it's over. We've got to keep doing that. And as we transition into looking at the infrastructure assets that we have at the site, trying to be mindful of what is needed into the future for the vision that the community is starting to portray to us, trying to put these all together. So keeping engaged is critical, more critical now probably than ever as far as the infrastructure goes. Some of our recent efforts, I think, represent some of what the government shows they can do well. Asset transfer, we've talked about this before, but about 300 jobs are going to come about because of the investments that have been made from diverting what would have been a stream to a landfill. We talked about those projects, one in each county so far, hopefully more. We're in the process of transferring some electrical components through the asset transition agreement to SODI, and what can't be used in commerce will be probably end up being recycled, and that will turn into a resource for the community to have as an investment. Well site that we're transferring to the village of Piketon looks like that'll be wrapped up this spring. Just up to our property and legal folks in Cincinnati office this week, in fact, and they're working on a bill of sale for the village of Piketon so we can actually make the actual transfer to them. We've segregated the wells from our system and it's ready to go. Piketon now has their easement in place to get access to it, so it's just about ready to go. For this spring, we'll be able to report out on that. And what's been really important and what I really wanted to talk about was the wells. and the Black County tie-in. On the west side, a lot of consternation. Contractor for the county is coming up an easement that we gave them, but they cross three electric lines for 345,000 kilovolts. It's enough to make the night callers crawl up every time it rains. And a lot of consternation crossing that. And how will we do it? In the old-fashioned way, we had guys with shovels down there so they wouldn't cut into it with a big tractor or backhoe. They dug with shovels across that and made the cross. Now we're coming in to be able to tie into our plant. But they have probably, if the weather was nice, a couple weeks worth of work to finish up on plant site. And then officially, Pike County sewer line will be tied into our plant and it'll be off site. And that has not been a small task, and it's been a lot of years in the making. And I think it just demonstrates the continued partnership that we've had with the county.
DOE still owns the plant.
DOE owns the plant? Mm-hmm. Okay. And we have an agreement to process or treat their sewage. And basically, they're paying us what they would pay the city of Waverly or village of Piketon. Okay. And so it'll cost them what if they send it up there, but they don't have the capacity in Piketon for unlimited growth. Yeah. We've got a lot of capacity that we can tap into. And then one that we haven't really talked about, but one of the investments that SODI made was to Pike County. This is paying for the engineering work and design work for a north side sewer line. That's going to be coming up Shyville Road. It's going to be able to expand over into here, and you'll see potentially growth that can be supported along 32 in Shyville, in addition to 23 on the west side. So it's really important for the development of the county, and I think really important also is we've talked about how you leverage money. $150,000 from that has actually attracted over $2.5 million other dollars, and so it's important. $150,000 doesn't sound like much, but when you leverage it, you can parlay it into something big. It's a huge deal for the county. And those of us that have been in development before know that's been a limiting factor for a long time. And so our partnership is helping us to address that. Let's see. And really, I think the important thing is this was another groundbreaking from down the side of the county. And Adrian, you guys can probably tell me how far along that is, because you got a lot of work to do working on that.
With Bill. Employed a lot of construction people to build that thing and get software from others, and they're actually selling product.
Selling product. So about 2 years ago, this was the groundbreaking.
That's it.
Took a little bit of money from SODI to help leverage about a $15 million project, all hinged on $150,000. It sounds crazy, but it's true, because the money that came from SODI was able to be used for whatever it was needed for. And that leveraged that project. And there's about 60 people working there today, full time, earning good wages, and they're selling product out of there. And the other thing was the infrastructure upgrades that we're doing to support our operations. You can see this was rail project, and in the background you can see an area. You're looking at the beginnings of a transloading facility. Some people call it multimodal or intermodal. We're building one out there. We just don't call it that. But it's where you put freight, bulk freight, on the rail from trucks. Right there it is. We've upgraded the rail because we have to have rail that's in good condition for the material that we're shipping out. When we're done shipping, you're going to have basically a first-class rail on privately owned track.
Where does this go out now?
Where this is tied to Norfolk Southern, so basically it crosses 32 and curls in behind Piketon Mound Cemetery.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
It goes by Ed Robbins Sawmill and on the main line there.
I see it now.
Looking forward. I think, again, can't say it enough, as we prepare to move into the proposed plan and the public comment period, we rely on you to stay engaged. It's going to be important that you made a recommendation to us, and that's appreciated, but also there'll be a public comment period, and it's important that people understand so that there's no misunderstanding as we make decisions going forward, but also we want to do things be the best partner we can be. Can't guarantee you we give everything that the community wants, but we certainly won't get it if we don't hear from you and tell us what it is. So we do value the input you've given us, and we do look at this as a partnership. And any questions, especially infrastructure? And no social media questions, no.
The last few years, we've sort of vacillated back and forth about the length of the project and funding and all that kind of stuff. And now we're talking tonight another 30-year, Maria referenced 30 years, which is obviously put us 2044, where we were, what, before Obama and all the other stuff that transpired. So, obviously the DOE train, it doesn't run, it crawls. And then your decision-making process and everything. So on your end as professionals, are you guys to the point of where you're saying there's not going to be expanded funding and we might as well just get ready for the long haul? Because if that is indeed the case, then we need to let the community know that, the public know that too. I mean, what's your thinking? What's your best thinking at this time?
You get to a record of decision and you have identified the path forward and you have a regulatory agreement,
yeah,
it's a whole lot easier for our congressional delegation to go and stand toe-to-toe with other legislators and say, we have commitments to, we have state of Ohio and the regulators on board. So getting through the regulatory process gives you more certainty of what you're doing. Also, you will have a defined scope of work with a defined duration that really is dependent on budget.
Okay.
But it will actually give ammunition, more ammunition to your legislators to fight for more budget when it's clearly defined. Because right now we're saying words like, if we choose the disposal cell or if we don't, there won't be ifs.
But then we read today where Paducah, already they're not even involved in really in D&D, and they've already got their governor and their other political people, and they're announcing about something new they're going to build on their site to employ people. So it's crazy. We're getting nothing from our, in my opinion, from our legislative people, or we're so far behind the curve, or we're so far down the food chain. And so we need to be realistic, I think, in really what's going on. So if you had a path forward, if you had the things you just talked about, we had all that worked out, if for some particular reason someone starts dumping millions of more dollars into our budget, would we be able to ramp up this project?
Or clear up? Clearly, budget dependent.
It's all budget dependent. I say 30 because that's the budget I have.
Right.
That's when you retire, right?
And that's, yeah.
hopefully before that, but that's funding dependent too. But my hope was always 20 years, that if they would get enough funding, it would be done in 20.
And again, that doesn't preclude development. Remember, we had this discussion.
Mm-hmm. I remember Joel's conversation
and
that very well.
And I wouldn't say we have a project to report on, but I can tell you that we are going through the process of identifying one parcel for sure, looking for others that are contiguous to get you something that you can market. And we are going through the new rules to make sure that doesn't adversely impact us, which it doesn't appear that it does. So we've not given up on development for 20 years.
You're referring to transfer of real estate.
But I think it's going to be a lot better for those that interact with members of Congress when you can lay out the plan and say, here it is. You know, and we want to get to this point so we can do something with the next generation of work at the plant site. It'll give you something you can point to that's more concrete.
Well, I like to think you're correct, but it just seems like our political folks really not are engaged, or they don't have the strength that we, other states, communities have. And so it's
hopefully the plan, the record of decision, will give something for them to rally around. It's an opportunity. Anything else? Thanks, guys. All right, no further questions for Greg? Outstanding, outstanding. We're going to slide forward on the agenda, administrative issues. We have under tab 5, draft recommendation 14-01. Will, would you be interested in picking up discussion on this recommendation? Is that
sure?
Or something you'd be thinking?
No.
Thank you, sir.
So everybody's had a couple months to review 1401 in advance. The idea is, by going ahead and encouraging the expansion of the asset recovery program at the site, it would potentially free up additional dollars for programs through the CRO, like what Greg was mentioning earlier with the four grants that were given out. I think the number was $4.4 million that had gone back into the D&D program and to the community through the CRO. That's a total amount. So any opportunity that we get to go ahead and keep things from going into a landfill final disposition and to be used in a productive way is a good thing. So that's kind of the thought process behind the recommendation that I wrote. I guess I'll just go ahead and read it.
Yeah, that's probably a good idea. What we'll do is we'll read at least the recommendation portion. You read the background if you choose. And then we'll entertain any discussion from the board, motion, and if there's a call to a vote. Then we'll have public comment on the recommendation and we'll go forward. It takes two-thirds of the members present to pass the recommendation. So that's, there's 10 of us here, so 10 of you here. That'll be 7 votes to pass if we get to that point. So. Well, where are you?
The recommendation is right there. It's really small. It says the Ports EMS SSAB recommends DOE provide continue. Continued support and funding for the Portsmouth Asset Recovery Program. Additionally, the Ports EMS SSAB recommends DOE aggressively pursue the expansion of the Asset Recovery Program as a way to mitigate waste and prioritize clean, cost-efficient, site-wide.
All right. Is there any discussion from the board on this recommendation?
One question on the 326 assets. Is that recoverable or does that have to go out to the Southwest?
You talking about the converters? That's not worth the effort there. So the next question was, we're trying to get the barrier down to 326 converter. I think we had a presentation, you guys have all back, that says, HEU, right? Because of your size, you know, what you get out of, if you did harvest it, it just doesn't make sense.
It's not economically feasible, what you're saying.
Have you looked at the structural steel in the 326?
So the structural steel, of course, we have to take into consideration, what the damage were and that kind of stuff to see if that was a viable option as well. We're looking at all because it's not just you have a little bit here and a little bit there, so there's a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But some of it, we have restrictions on what we can release in the conversion.
The material in the other two buildings, is it recoverable?
We're looking at the barrier material in the other two, the 33 and the 30 buildings. And I think we mentioned to you guys before that we're looking at the process to see if it is if the technology is viable to address that. We haven't vetted that, so probably
not a done deal yet.
I recommend that we vote on it.
Okay. We have a motion to proceed with the recommendation.
Second.
Okay. All right, so we have a second. Any further comments or discussion from the board before we go to public comment? Are there any members of the public that would like to provide comment on this recommendation? Could raise your hand. All right. I see two. Are there others? Jeffrey and David. Right. So you'll have 1 minute to provide your comments on this recommendation. And please identify yourself.
Jeffrey goes first.
Yeah. David Manure, Manure Chemical Consulting. This is a good initiative with one major proviso, and that is there needs to be as close to absolute certainty as possible that any material that goes off-site as far as recycling has been characterized for chemical and radiological contamination. There's a history at the site of this not being done, and unfortunately that keeps me very busy tracking it down. And I'm not on the inside, so it's unclear to me what type of safeguards are in place to ensure that recycled material is as free of chemical and radiological contamination as possible.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. Caesar?
Jeffrey C. I don't know who writes these, but as someone who used to teach writing in college and otherwise, there's a very common mistake made in the way these are drafted, which is the idea that if you say something, it makes it true. And very often it doesn't. It doesn't make it true. Twice this recommendation uses the word universal support. That makes it sound like there isn't universal support. It makes it sound silly. And there's an objection to the line that says, to allow the Ports Reservation to not only be an economic staple in southern Ohio, but to emerge as a hub for future development and growth. That has no place in this resolution. It's irrelevant. And nobody thinks that's true. This site is most likely not going to be redeveloped industrially or commercially. This site is probably going to wind up being a park or something. So I recommend taking that line out.
Thank you. All right, as a board, you've heard comments from the public. Do you have any additional thoughts or comments you guys would like to add? All right, seeing none, we have a motion on the table for a public comment. Are we good to take a vote? Okay. All right, so all those in favor of passing recommendation 1401 as presented, please raise your right hand. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All those opposed? Abstentions? All right, so that is 901, and that recommendation passes. Okay, thank you guys for your work on that recommendation. And your, I'm going to slide forward to subcommittee reports. Under tab 6, we have the budget and funding subcommittee. Stan, if you make sure you got a mic in front of you, sir.
Okay, thank you. We met here on January the 14th, and 4 p.m. and all the stuff, the committee on that was present. We had the board members here also. And Dennis Carr, and he was one of the speakers for us, and he came to budget of $340 million for D&D. And, you know, then the big challenge that's brought out at our subcommittee will be the FY 2015, which, you know, we've had Senator Brown and Senator Portman, you know, to ask for a budget, I think it's $450 million. There's also the, always with the uranium prices are now going down, will they stay down, will they come back up? That's a bargaining question. So funding is very important. It's very important we get to our senators, and after we try to get them to help us get plenty of money here, which is unhappy. And that's really all the subcommittee had.
Perfect. Any questions for Stan and his group?
Dan, do you remember what Dennis said was on the 340? How much of that is water?
No, I have it there to have. I can find my notes here real quick.
Is it bad? Maybe Joel speak to him.
I think it's bargaining with like $240 million, I think. And we actually ended up around $35 to $40 million more than we thought we would. Have a central ground to do it, I feel, and going right in our direction, and asking for it.
Thank you, Steve.
Okay, thank you.
Perfect, thank you, sir. You may have noticed the farther that Adrian moved the microphone, the farther standing in the lane. Have to talk to him about that.
I'm used to being pretty loud if I union meetings. We don't have a microphone, so.
All right. Community engagement site legacy. Sharon, you want to fill in for Sharon, do you mind?
Thank you, Matt. It was our presentation, we actually went on January 14th. It was our presentation from Jack Williams with the virtual museum update. And it was just a discussion of the traveling displays. And we were able to give input on what we wanted those to look like. It was all a rough draft and any changes that we wanted to make. And we had a discussion on the science poll, which is actually tomorrow. And decided that we were going to put them on display at the chamber banquet that was held on January 23rd. Pretty much that thing was the discussion and everything was about the traveling displays and science goal and outreach type.
How was the display received?
Sorry?
How was the display received at the banquet?
Good, and it actually gave us an opportunity to discussion at one of our subcommittee meetings after this, we discussed how it was received, and it worked out very well as far as the information that we had on it and it being very attractive, and a lot of people liked it and enjoyed the legacy information on it. But we did have discussion at that point on the ease of transportation and how stable it was or not, and since then we'll cover that on one of the other topics. Yeah.
And then we discussed trying a couple other designs. Okay. Good. All right. Thank you, ma'am. Under tab 8, you have the executive committee summaries. Mr. Kenderson, sir.
Subcommittees, how things were going with those. Talked a little bit about the membership package, about the process that's going on with that, where we're at in the process. I guess we're still at headquarters, is that correct? And so they're vetting those applications and doing background checks and that sort of stuff. How many applications did we send on up to headquarters in that packet?
About six.
Six for order, six?
Six new and reappointments. Six new and reappointments. Four reappointments, is that correct? If I remember? It's the majority of the board.
Okay, and we have six that went up and we have six vacancies, correct?
Yes, that gave us a full complement when we sent them in.
Okay, all right.
I think we are waiting to receive the draft back from headquarters. I think the last thing I saw from headquarters was they finished their review and they're going to send us the Word documents back. We send it to them, they review it, and then we submit it through DOE, and then they do a formal submission.
Who else goes off this year besides me? I don't know.
Wishful thinking.
Interesting.
So that's really kind of what we've been going over in the executive sessions. Are there any questions?
Thank you, sir. All right, under tab 9, we have the Recycling and Waste Disposition Subcommittee. Dick?
Okay, in February, the... I'm sorry, what? In February, the Waste Disposition Recycling Subcommittee met. There were myself, Al Don, Frank, and Brian Mew were present, and Stan Pratt and Sharon Manson were also in attendance. One of the things that went on then was the RIFS update with Mark Hewitt from FBP. We discussed that quite a bit this evening already, but his presentation was pretty detailed and pretty informative. Also, there was we addressed the plumes that we talked about tonight, and he explained that the dirt in the old plumes we use is filled for the on-site disposal center. The question is how to make it work from a regulatory standpoint. I think that's been discussed tonight. Frank indicated, has anyone showed the congressional representatives how much money will be saved? And Mark Jewett said, yes, that has been done. I don't know how that's quantified, but it has been done. And that was it.
Okay. Any questions for Dick for his segment?
I thought it was a very informative reading.
You guys covered a lot of ground last few months.
Okay.
All right. Under tab 10, I believe it is, site optimization, future land use. Mr. Keeper, sir?
We met on January 14th. Unfortunately, I was not able to attend that particular meeting. But I understand Leslie Kusick came and talked to the group about the particulars of land transfer and its relation to the piping site. I guess in part of her talk was in response to a letter that DOE had basically come out with saying that land would not be transferred from DOE sites with active permissions. Basically, from what I understand or from what I've read is that she said that it really doesn't apply in all ways to the piped-in site, and that land transfer should still be possible if going through the right channels. So that was basically that meeting. We met also on February 11th. Karen Price came and talked to us briefly about site optimization and infrastructure. I asked a question of whether there would be a mention of the master plan in the ROD, basically a master plan including an integration of cleanup, site optimization, and green space. It was in one of the recommendations that our committee made. And it was said that would not be in the ROD, but that 4BW would be required to work out one of those plans. That was basically in the main discussion, and I adjourned the meeting.
Okay. Any questions for Brian?
Well, what was the support for why we're not in the ROD? Was it apropos?
They said it would be too complicated. I think that was kind of, it just complicates things.
sorry. Who was the contractor that SSAB was working with to develop a master plan? At one time there was...
That was SSAB, wherever that is. It was SSAB consultants or...
Is that kind of stale right now, or...
Until we get to a little bit further down the road, the next phase of that will kick off when we go a little further down the road. We do have a requirement, I believe we require Florida to put together a master plan, and so they will engage again. That one will be SSAB, but it'll be a continuation of SSAB's original work.
Okay.
If they have the competencies they need to continue with, maybe we will...
It's going to be done, though.
That's required in the contract.
Are there other questions for Brian?
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
All right, we'll move forward to public comment portion of tonight's agenda. I have two members of the public that wish to have time on the agenda. We ask that you, if possible, keep your comments within the scope of the board. We realize it's a public comment period. Well, we'll have 4 minutes set aside for each of you. I'll kind of plug you down to about 30 seconds left and kind of close out your comments. So, first will be Jeffrey Seat.
Jeffrey Seat, Neighbors for an Ohio Valley Alternative. Well, mainly what I want to focus on tonight is that you folks on the SSAB are not getting the straight story from DOE. And we've talked about this in the past, but tonight there were some particularly egregious examples of that. Greg gave a presentation which was in the pattern of past presentations about the history of the plant, about how the community has been nothing but supportive of the Atomic Energy Mission. How many of you knew that there was an Amish community in Pike County that lived in Camp Creek, very close to the plant site, that picked up and left entirely in protest because of the siting of the A plant and moved to Canada, which is information online. Pike County lost its entire Amish community because of the siting of this plant. How many of you knew that there was a Native American community in Pike County that was so upset by the siting of the A plant that they came and did their own radiation surveys in 1952 because they were convinced that this site was going to be permanently contaminated and desecrated? How many of you knew that an emergency committee of archaeologists and naturalists was formed in Columbus and Washington, D.C. because they were so concerned that the siting of this plant would destroy valuable animal habitat and important archaeological sites? How many of you knew that a major landowner in the community leased his large portion of his property to quarry companies, which I'm sure you're familiar with some of the quarries in the area, in order to ensure that his children did not remain in the community because he was afraid they would get cancer from this facility? And I could go on and on. But that is a side of the story that needs to be part of the history, not just boosterism. The leak of radioactive water that was referred to tonight by Joel in January was much more serious than you were told. Okay, I received calls about that almost immediately after it happened. I called Jeff Bezos, I had a discussion with him. He told me that 40,000 gallons of water leaked. Joel said tonight that there were 20,000 gallons of water that leaked. Jeff assured me, promised me, that he would send me a copy of the incident report on that leak. Didn't happen, never received anything about it. We tonight are putting in a formal request because of this incident that we and the community be given copies of every incident report on everything that happens at this site. of an unusual nature every time an incident report is filed. That is part of transparency, which DOE claims.
About 30 seconds.
And we think the SSAB should ask for those same things. Why don't you ask for the incident report? And we want to see all the past incident reports on everything that has happened on this site, so the community groups and the SSAB can review that material and see what the truth is, not hear these 30-second summaries, as we heard tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sager. Appreciate your comments. Dr. Minuta.
Thank you. David Minuta, Minuta Chemical Consultant. Just one primary comment. Now, I don't get involved with a lot of regulatory issues, so when I was listening to Joel's presentation and then the discussion with Maria, the issue to me that came up was kind of striking was whether process building was considered one category, when there's a world of difference between what went on in each of the three buildings, 326, 330, and 333. Now, I'm aware today, in 2014, better than 30 years after most of the important laws went into effect, is the fact that we'll have demolition going on in 326, and I'm directly aware of, where we're now getting a third generation worker sick because of the failure, and I'm not sure who to pin the blame on, but there is a failure to adequately categorize for both chemical and radiological contamination, and that workers who were not actively engaged at the site during operations are actually not even briefed before they go in to do work. So I've spent a considerable period of time recently with both the security guards, police force, and also the current steel workers. Just what in the world is going on to where demolition activities are going on without any idea what's being turned over? And 326 is probably the worst, but the fact is, significant investigation has to go on in all three process buildings where you've thoroughly documented as much as you possibly can before you deploy human beings in to do the actual teardown. And so there may be regulatory issues far beyond what my pay grade is, but on the science and engineering, it's appalling that we are getting a third generation of workers sick, and someone needs to be held accountable for that.
Thank you for your comments. I'm sorry. Next item on the agenda is final comments from the board. Are there any members of the board that would like to provide comment at this time? Brian?
I am for total disclosure, and I feel the community should know anything that's available. Jeffrey C. seems to think that he should have an incident report for this particular accident. And if there's no reason that this incident report can't be made public and given to us and members of the public, I'd like to see that happen. I'd like to see it. And particularly, I'd also like to see an unredacted copy of something like that come out, just because I know sometimes things are not always put in writing clearly. And my second comment is kind of relating to what Mr. Minuto said. I personally know people who have been in the buildings recently as contractors, and they do testing on them, and one of the guys I know came up with high levels of beryllium. So I just want to say that some of those contaminants are out there. This guy had no idea that he would come in contact with anything like this. And that's basically my comment.
Thank you. Thank you. And I took after your request for that.
Thank you.
That's a long story. Are there other comments from the board?
Yeah, I would like to ask Dr. Benita. Dr. Benita, where's your information coming from? Third generation people are getting cancer, getting sick.
Directly from the steel workers and from the protective forces.
But how are you getting access to that?
I'm actually under contract now to the steel workers, where I'll meet with the safety committee periodically. And so I am in the direct pipeline now for getting information on that. And having worked at the plant for a long time and having some influence back when I was active, it shocked me to me that basically people like me are the last of Mohicans. And it's only after an incident takes place, my phone will ring or I'll get an email and it'll be, we need to talk to you, because on more than one occasion now, these incidents are taking place and they are particularly disturbing.
Sure.
Thank you.
You're
welcome.
Other questions, comments?
Yeah, I have a question. It, along the logic that we've talked about tonight, or at least in his closing comments, as a member of the SSAB, as a board member, where do we go to get the straight answer? I mean, obviously, where do we go to get the straight answer? I mean, Jeffrey has his persuasion, David talks about his, DOE has theirs. Where do we get the straight answer?
Well, those. I'm not going to testify ours.
I'm not asking anyone justify.
I would assume that these comments from the public are documented and sent into DOE or to the SSAB administrators. And I have no record myself of how many of those have been addressed or answered for that matter. Now, that may be something we could look at.
Do we need to be asking some different questions?
Well, that's true, but from my own experience working at the plant, if you were going into a rad area, you know this too, that you would get a briefing before you went in as to what was in there and what effects it may have on you while you're exposed to it for the length of time that you're going to be in there.
Well, it just doesn't make sense to me that DOE would want people to be harmed, that it would make any sense whatsoever.
So we
need to find out what the protocol is and what's going on, what's really happening, and get rid of the hyperbole and all the emotion and all the stuff that's...
The contractors that are going in there and working for DOE should have safety briefings, they should have RAD briefings. When I worked at the plant, I knew generally through training what you're going to be exposed to.
Well, if that indeed is happening, then there should be a paper trail of that.
There should be.
Yeah.
There should be. Now, Frank, you worked in the process area.
Yeah. But I don't, not just here, but in a nuclear power plant or any place like that, there is a great deal of tracking.
Now, Dick is right historically that this is actually what went on. Historically, what you're saying is what went on, where all of us were trained, we were briefed. Now, the exception to that were the security guards and the police force, because oftentimes they didn't have an opportunity to get properly dressed because their responsibility was to respond. Okay, and I think that's an important issue to bring up, is that those who had to respond now didn't have the time to don what we call PPE, personal protective equipment. But I think the situation we're running in today is people like you and me, or Frank for that matter, are not active on a daily basis on the site. And the result is the contractors are brought in, and some of them are on a rotating basis. 2 years here, 2 years at the next site, where they're not here long enough to understand the history.
What I was saying is part of their contract. Sure.
Hang on a second.
Language in that contract.
Just point of order.
Yes.
Sure.
the EMS SSAB has a clearly defined scope. And for right or wrong, worker safety is not within the scope of the SSAB. Risk assessment, risk management are listed, and how DOE offsets that risk is there.
Talk offline.
If we need to explain, or ask for a presentation explaining what are some of the processes to go through to maintain.
That makes sense. But for clarification.
No, there's no clarification. This is not the forum for that discussion right now. And so we will.
David said there were third generation effects. Those aren't workers.
And so what we want to make sure that we follow is that we stay within scope. We just stay focused on what we're supposed to do. And I appreciate this discussion because I think it's important. There is clearly a concern from you guys and from the communities and making sure. Jim Rispoli, who used to be the Dave Pazinga, said that his number one goal was making sure everybody went home at the end of the day. The work that takes place at these sites has risk. We know that. There are dangers associated. So what do we do to offset those risks and make sure everybody gets home? And at the end of the day, that's what we want to make sure to do. But if that's something, Val, we need to talk about and pursue. We need to show some open spots. Find a work plan going forward. We can find the right spot. Make sure you guys are comfortable. Are there other comments from the board? Okay, seeing none, Will?
We're here.